Welcome to another episode of Yesterday's Capers. I'm Abdullah Moallim, and every week I'll be bringing you the very best shows from the past that the world has to offer. It's a real witching session this week as we take a look back at the worst witch and the Belfry witches. And we take a special look at Sabrina the Teenage Witch, another cracking show starring teen actress icon Melissa Joan Hart. So, let's get started. And joining me as ever, it's producer Paul.
Hey man, how's it going?
I'm all right, thanks. I'm all right. How are you?
Yeah, not too bad. This is a mega week this week. Quite enjoyed it.
It is, isn't it? So it's the witching hour, if you want. Yes. I'm gonna say two good shows.
Yeah.
And the other one,
two and a half, I think.
The other one left a lot to be desired for me.
Yeah, I think I'm hoping we're on the same page this week. I think it was pretty clear what was completely terrible, especially the first episode of this particular show that I'm not even going to name just yet. I clawed my way through it.
I think we're going to be different. I think it's going to be another half and half and girlfriends episode. Oh dear, oh dear. But yeah, we're gonna start with Sabrina the Teenage Witch, and this show came out in September 1996. Some of the things happening in the world. Elijah Izetbegovic is elected president of Bosnia and Herzegovina in the country's first election since the Bosnian War. If I said the name wrong, apologies. A multi-million dollar salvage effort fails to retrieve parts of the Titanic after a cable snapped, sending the vessel back to the depths of the sea, of course. Archaeologists believe that they have found the heart of Robert the Bruce after uncovering an ancient casket in Melrose Abbey in Scotland. The first Wives Club was in the cinemas. And Ready or Not by the Fugees was number one in the charts. Right, so now we're talking about Sabrina the Teenage Witch, and I am delighted to say that joining us is comedian and YouTuber and Melissa Joan Hart stan, Nabs Pats.
Yay, thank you. I'm glad to be here. And I'm good, thank you, as well as can be in the midst of like the second wave that is upon us in this pandemic. I cannot believe I'm saying second wave.
You know, I think House Party is going to be like, oh, we're back in business. We're back in business.
Yeah, never really caught on to a House Party. It's been Zoom all the way.
Yeah, it's been Zoom. I think I've done a couple of House Parties, because I think with House Party you can like get like a load of people. You could play like games on your phone on House Party of all the other people. And
yeah, yeah, you're showing your youthful disposition there, Abdullah. I'm showing my age.
Youth. I wouldn't say it was youthful. It was just one of those things where my friend was like, oh, look, House Party, let's all go to House Party. And then I think you see like loads of people with like their phones or whatever, and they're like playing all these games on. But that's going to be back in prominence again, I reckon. Yeah.
Okay, so I'll probably be getting a few notifications, because that's what I got at the first round of the pandemic. Like, oh, such and such person is in House Party. Do you want to join? I was like, why have I not been invited to this? Huh? Like, why is House Party inviting me? Why are my friends who apparently are in this House Party not inviting me? And I just feel kind of like hacked off from that. You know, it's like being at school again. It's like, you know, when you're trying to be in with the in crowd. Yeah, it brought all those feelings again. So yeah, let's end this discussion on House Party right now.
I was going to say, it's like the WhatsApp group everyone's in and you're not somehow.
Or it's a bit like everyone's an admin and you're not.
That is the worst.
Yes. It's like, why can't I have exit powers or adding powers? Like, what is it about me that doesn't deserve this accolade?
They might think you're going to put them in your next joke or something. That's why. Yeah, they don't want you to have all that power.
There is method in their madness, huh?
Right, Sabrina the Teenage Witch. We're going to do a bit of admin before we pass on to you. So it was originally created by writer George Gladier and artist Dan DiCarlo, and it first appeared in Archie's Madhouse issue number 22, which dates back to 1962. And storylines of the character at elementary school age is also appearing under the title Sabrina, that cute little witch, in almost all of the Little Archie comics. And the series is basically about Sabrina being a half-witch. Her mother is an ordinary human or mortal, as which is referred to them, while her father is a warlock, and he lives and she lives with her two aunts, Hilda and Zelda Spellman, both witches themselves, in the fictional town of Greendale, which is located somewhere near Riverdale in the home of Archie Andrews. And she also lives with three women as the family and the family pet Salem, who's a witch who has been turned into a cat as punishment for world domination attempts. And Sabrina's primary romantic interest is her mortal boyfriend, Harvey Kinkle, who, like nearly all the other mortals in Sabrina's world, is unaware his girlfriend is a witch. And the American TV sitcom that we're going to be talking about was created by Nell Scovell, and of course based on the Archie comic series of the same name. And it stars Melissa Joan Hart as Sabrina Spellman, who is a teenager on her 16th birthday, and she discovers that she has magical powers. And she lives with her 600-year-old aunts, Hilda and Zelda, and their magical talking cat, Salem. And they live in the fictional Boston suburb of Westbridge, Massachusetts, throughout most of the series. And as a novice witch, her spells often go awry, and her aunts, Hilda and Zelda Spellman, counsel her on the proper use of her magic and give her moral advice. Additionally, Hilda and Zelda must take care of Salem Saberhagen, who is a witch turned into a cat. And the show included contemporary pop culture references, with Sabrina often saying she liked Britney Spears and No Doubt. It also mentions human history alongside witches, such as the Salem Witch Hunt, which Zelda tells Sabrina was not a real hunt for witches. And Hilda mentions to Sabrina in episode one that for 2 months, a bunny ruled all of England, causing the witches' council to turn back time, as if to say that mortals are ignorant at the most. And there was one episode that suggests that Jerry Springer is a witch when he hosts the Jerry Springer Show in the other realm, whereas the comic series, animated series, was set in the fictional Greendale. TV show was set in Boston, and ultimately, yeah, it ran for 7 seasons. I didn't know how long the show went on for. So did you like Sabrina the Teenage Witch as much as you liked Clarissa Explains It All?
Okay, so I was in that comparative phase where I was comparing Sabrina to Clarissa because I was such a fan of Clarissa. And so it didn't quite do it for me as Clarissa did. But I did watch it from start to finish because I was such a Melissa Joan Hart fan. I was loyal to her. But I remember, you know, I think on our terrestrial TV expansion days where we got Freeview and E4 was around. I don't really watch E4 anymore, but I know they were playing the reruns. And so I caught the second wind, as we are currently living through the second wave. I caught the second wind of Sabrina the Teenage Witch, and I believe I became a fan second time round. I just wasn't ready for it first time round. And I put that down to the fact that I think I was quite mature for someone who was just approaching her teens and just didn't like the whole genre of supernatural stuff, witchcraft. I was like, you know what? I know that you're trying to push out parallels to real life. Like, you're trying to cover issues that happen to us youngsters from a young age. But the thing is, I can't really like digest it in this format of witchcraft. So that just didn't appeal to me as a youngster, but it did for my peers. They loved it. Like, they were quite happy to be transported to this fantasy world where Sabrina in her teenage years was able to, you know, navigate the ups and downs of teenage life through wizardry. Yes, that's right. That was a bit of a tongue twister for me. Did you never catch it, Abdullah?
I mean, with Sabrina, yeah, because I remember like it first came on like Saturday nights on ITV. And obviously Saturday nights in the 90s, if you remember, was like the one. And it used to kind of always start, for me, it used to start like at 12 o'clock watching Grandstand on BBC One. So watch all the sports, get that out of the way. And then 5 o'clock would be Sabrina Teenage Witch. Then after that would be Gladiators. Then after that would be Blind Date. And then after that, it would be either Noel Edmonds' House Party or Family Fortunes.
I'm so impressed by your memory recall for the schedule.
And then at the end of Saturday night, if I could stay up long enough, I'd watch Match of the Day.
Oh, wow. That deserves a round of applause, man. That was impressive. I mean, you know what? I blame today's catch-up TV for really messing up with my memory recall. Because, you know, I mean, like, we used to schedule TV shows. Like, did you ever collect the monthly what's on TV or radio times and then sit there circling your shows that you wanted to watch? Because there were always going to be TV remote control wars if you didn't pre-prepare.
But no, like, yeah, Saturday was like the one. And like Sabrina Teenage Witch used to always be the show that you would watch at 5 o'clock.
Yeah.
And then, unfortunately for Sabrina Teenage Witch, BBC One purchased this cartoon. I'm not sure if you heard of it, The Simpsons. Yeah, some cartoon called The Simpsons. Once they purchased that, it was like game over for Sabrina at that time slot. And I think they had to like move it to another time slot because everybody thought, oh, I'm going to watch The Simpsons at this time. And
there was a ratings war with the big shots.
Sucks to be Sabrina Teenage Witch. But even then as a kid, like I kind of liked it. I thought it was a pretty cool show. Like Salem was very funny and sarcastic.
Yes, he was.
It was a good show. I actually liked it back then. And even now, like watching some of the episodes, as we'll talk about in a minute, like it was pretty fun watching the older episodes of Sabrina. I think once they changed the theme song and she stops being Sabrina the Teenage Witch and Sabrina the Adult Witch who's going to college and getting married and all of that stuff, I think it kind of lost its way a bit for me.
Yeah, it lost its way in general, because I think there was a bit of from what I was reading before this show. You will be glad to hear that I come pre-prepared with some factual information. I think after the third or fourth series, that's where there was a bit of a negotiation war happening between the networks and the producers of the show. And so you just realize, like, you know, when a show starts to go downhill and it disappoints you because actually like some characters drop off, whatever, what's behind it is pure economics. It's essentially low budget transferring of the show from one network, which was, I believe it was ABC, to something else. And clearly, it's not that memorable to me, so it really wasn't prominent. ABC, I'm still familiar with that. As someone who lives in the UK, I know that it's one of the major networks. So when you lose that prominence, and clearly there was a reduction in budget, then the storyline gets impacted. So that's what's behind the story, the whole show kind of coming to an end in not so kind of fanfare fashion.
And what about you, Producer Paul? What did you think of this show?
I watched this show with my sister. You were talking earlier about that, the remote wars that used to happen. And my sister used to win this one every single time. This was her show.
So you watched it under duress, basically.
But it's one of those things, is, oh no, do I really have to watch it? And then be sat there glued to it for half an hour that it's on. I quite like this. And like you said, like Salem was really funny. Like, you know, just it was a pretty good show, even first time around for me. And I'm sure this like paved way for like the Harry Potters and things like that, because of like, you know, getting people a little taste for witchcraft and things like this, you know. I like the show. I thought it was quite cool. But I'm glad you said about the economics and things like that, because, I mean, was it Zelda in the final episode was played by a candle? And I was a bit put off by that because I skipped like right to the end and I was like,
they couldn't afford the character who played Zelda in the end. They were like, let's just get a wax candle.
Yeah, and I was a bit like, what the hell's going on here? But anyway, yeah. And I definitely remembered some of the episodes as I was watching them this time around. Yeah, I mean, although it was like, obviously for like young teenage girls or preteen girls, or, you know, probably the demographic for this, I'm sure a lot of like even young boys and even older men were probably watching this because their daughters were watching it, you know. And it's one of those times when you didn't have, you know, million TVs in your house with, or on your phones and things like this. It's like you had a TV in your house and that was the thing that was on at the time, so you had to watch it, like it or lump it.
It's like grin and bear it, Gladiators will be on in a minute, don't yeah. worry, just watch this Sabrina the Teenage Witch, and I don't know, Catchphrase, if it comes on after that. It's just like, oh, for God's sake, just Gladiators, hurry up and come on. And it's like, all right, fine.
So it's, you know, interesting just... that you told me that it was on at 5 o'clock, because clearly I'd forgotten about that information.
Like 5:30, round about that time.
That's quite intriguing, because what that says is it was on at a time that was acceptable for youngsters and adults. And if you think about it, I mean, there was no other real television channels that were really making a mark. It was really still back in the day. It was the BBCs and it was the ITVs and it was Channel 4 and maybe Channel 5. So whatever was scheduled was very important. So that show was prominent and it hit the age ranges really well. So this was for youngsters and adults alike. So in that sense, it really did do well, and it's definitely a cult classic. And I know that there has been, I believe last year to this year, there was the release of a new revamped version of Sabrina, the Teenage Witch. They called it The Chilling Adventures of Sabrina. Now, when you add chilling to the title, that kind of explains why it doesn't really go far. And doesn't really melt the hearts of its audience and hardcore fans. I saw on Facebook, I remember this, when this new series was being released, and they got the old cast to rewatch some of these new episodes, and they were frightened by some of the scenes they were watching. And actually, it was really telling when Melissa herself was like, I'm not going to get my kids to watch this. It's a bit too adult. So the original series as a standalone is successful, but it kind of, you can't replicate it because it just doesn't quite work with today's production value, etc. It just didn't work.
No, I didn't think so either. And I'm actually glad you mentioned the chilling adventures of Sabrina, because we'll talk about that in a little bit later. So let's talk about episodes we watched. I do have like a summary of all of what happens in the season, so like as we're kind of talking about episodes, I can kind of sort of...
This is so cool. Who needs Wikipedia when you're around, Abdullah?
Yeah, I mean there was 7 seasons. There was quite a lot to break down and decipher, because I think producer Paul messaged me, oh, is there any particular episodes you should watch? And I was like, just watch what you like, really. I'm sure there is like the one episode to watch, but I couldn't quite pick. So I just kind of went with the ones that kind of stood out to me. That's what I kind of picked. So obviously, yeah, season one is just about Sabrina trying to keep a balance between being a teenager and having magical powers. And she has a teacher, Mr. Poole, that she's always having a to and fro with. And the pilot, did you...
I remember the pilot. I do remember the pilot, because you've got to remember when Sabrina hit the screens, it was something that all Clarissa fans were excited to watch. So when you have that much anticipation... Yes, I forgot what time the show was on and on which channel, but I do remember vividly the first episode. And actually, unlike quite a lot of pilots, it did really well. Like, in fact, it was even a stronger pilot than Clarissa's pilot.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean,
Clarissa felt like it was one of those where, right, let's give it a go, see how it goes.
Yeah, it was very experimental.
Yeah, and this one appears more polished. It appeared like, right, This is a legitimate program. This is gonna sell. This is gonna do well at this point. And
it's a clear-cut premise. So the story is defined. You've got the background spelled out in this pilot. It's actually in terms. I mean, like I've because of my now midlife crisis and the comedy world I've entered. I've been doing quite a few workshops on script writing and sitcom writing, and so for me, returning back to some of the old shows that I've watched, I love to watch the pilots in particular because pilots are the foremost episode. I mean, you can get it horribly wrong as well. But if you get it right, then one of the reasons why you get it right is because, and take note of the learning in case you're planning to create a groundbreaking sitcom. Yes, I see. I see you've got your biro in hand. Good, good, good. it's the fact that you introduce all the characters, you introduce the background, and you give the audience a real flavor of the journey you're about to be taken on. And that's what Sabrina the Teenage Witch and its pilot achieved. So kudos to the creators for that. And of course, like the premise was great. Premise is Sabrina enters a new town. Her parents are somewhat broken up. And this really appealed, I remember, at school, like for a lot of kids who came from homes where their parents had split up. This was really comforting for a lot of people to watch this. And then there's this mystery. The mystery is resolved on her 16th birthday, where she's levitating, and her aunt, who she's gone to stay with in this new town, enter because they're in on the secret, which is that Sabrina is a witch, and she has now assumed all her powers of witchcraft on her 16th birthday. And so begins the journey of how she's about to fit in to her new life, taking on this new talent. I really do think her superpowers represented for all of us as youngsters, like, you know, everyone in school, we're all so diverse and we all have our different abilities. And so her witchcraft, which was her superpowers, represented like all the different types of talents you as a kid could have. Like maybe you've got a talent in sports, or maybe you've got a talent when it comes to mathematics. It's a weird one to have, but still some kids do have that. I wasn't one of them. And maybe you just love reading, or and maybe you're great at storytelling. So it's like your very own superpowers. Like if you think this witchcraft was representing parallels in our lives as youngsters. And so like you enter a new world, you've got a kind of broken home that you're coming from, and then you're entering a new space and you're trying to navigate that. And how are you going to fit in? And so that was the start of a like really compelling story. And of course, like I talk as though like I was sucked into this. I really wasn't in the first time round. I was second time round when I was a little bit more older and I could appreciate it for its finer points. Otherwise, like I was just like, as a kid, when I watched it first time round, I was like, I don't believe in witches. I always knew Father Christmas was not real. So like, you know, why am I, what value am I going to get from this? Like I liked Clarissa because I was a bit mature for my, you know, school days. And, you know, I love the fact that, you know, she's talking about her angst and struggles and her sibling rivalry through the lens of, hey, I'm this independent young kid and I have a voice. That's what Clarissa was. And Sabrina was navigating teenage life, but through witchcraft. I could not relate to that. I really could not relate to that. But I appreciate it now.
Yeah, I did as well. And obviously, like in the episode, I did like how she's like levitating in her sleep. And it's like, oh, she's 16. She's going to be a witch. And her aunties are telling her that she's a witch. And obviously, she's not having it. She's like, I'm not a witch. What are you talking about? I'm just a normal teenage girl or whatever. And she's in school and they have to like dissect a frog. The frog ends up being alive again.
Yes.
And then she encounters Libby, who is like the one of those, like, you know, girls in school who's just like absolute nightmare, spills a drink all over Sabrina. And then obviously Libby's like, yeah, prove it.
Libby is everyone's favorite bully that we all love to hate at school.
Love to hate?
Yeah.
Where's the love bit? I was watching, I was thinking, oh, you are wicked, Libby.
Yeah, no, she basically, I knew a few girls who were my very own Libby. And I was Melissa in real life. You know, like, you know, you go
Sabrina,
yeah. Well,
Melissa.
I was always the Melissa buff. Remember, I was not fooled by this witchcraft as a kid. So I was like, yeah, the Sabrina is Melissa. Melissa is Clarissa, and Clarissa explains it all. Remember that.
You say that. When I was a kid, I thought Salem was a real talking cat. I mean, now I look at it, I know it's just a doll. But
it was so badly done, Salem. Like, the technology was, I mean, like, there's this new reinvented Chilling Adventures of Sabrina. It's a real cat.
Yeah, obviously, and they've got capabilities. The
yes,
but obviously on our tiny little TV, and what was it, 480p quality? Like, Salem looked real. I'm like, oh, the talking cat.
It's amazing what you can do with a poorly pixelated screen
on the lens of like high definition. And obviously, we're like doing shows about witches. You could see like everything is just so fake. Like, I know you ain't riding that broom. Like, who are you trying to fool? But back then,
But back then, yeah. It was, I mean, but the thing is, you could dismiss all of that because Salem was just so fun to watch and fun to listen to, because his little quips just, it was great, because it's like you got a teenager who's going through like her struggles, and it's like seeing the funny side to the tragedy. And Salem was definitely the comedic voice, and so was Aunt Hilda.
Yeah, I was going to say, I liked one of the aunts more than the other one.
But I think
it
must have
been Hilda.
I loved the combination of the aunts, because do you know what they represented? Those two together became the balancing act for what parents represent. You know, you always have like the good cop, bad cop. And through their kind of personality differences, you could really see like there's someone who provides the rational voice, there's the other who kind of provides the light relief moments, just so that every situation is bearable. And it's like you need that balancing act. And those two sisters really represented like the surrogate parents that, you know, because the parents were absent. One was in another realm, the other was like safeguarding herself so that Sabrina, if she caught sight of her, would then turn into something. I don't know what, but yeah. But I mean, that's just like another, that's just code for parents are divorced and they've left you. That's what that was.
Yeah. And so obviously the episode is like Sabrina, she kind of shows herself to be a witch by turning Libby into a pineapple. And so she goes to the witch's council and wants to relive that day all over again and just do it differently. And she manages to ask Harvey to the cinemas just before Harvey gets invited to the big popular party. And Salem's talking about how he misses being a human being. And yeah, obviously the time reversal works, invites Harvey to the movies, and the drink ends up spilling on Libby. And that was the pilot, which I thought was really, really fun. And did you watch any others from season one, Paul? Or
yeah, so I watched episodes 1 and 2 back to back to try a feel, you know, try and get into it.
Yeah,
so,
talk about episode 2 then.
Right, so this one is about Sabrina again, like progressing on her magic. Like, you know, she's still pretty rubbish at it. And one thing I like, this kind of reminded me of a bit of Harry Potter, and because she does this thing where she can't do the magic, and Hilda comes up and says, oh, like, you know, try this trick because it's easy and it's a hoot. She loves it. And she goes, she gets a hat and she puts her hand in it and she pulls out a rabbit. And then Zelda's like, oh, you know, that's so bad, that trick, that even mortals are doing it. And I quite like this thing where, you know, where things leak out into the mortal realm and, you know, so people kind of know a little bit. You know, it becomes a myth in the real world, and I quite like that little play. Anyway, so Salem has read her diary. I didn't write what he said, but it's obviously annoyed her, and she's chucked him out. And one thing I liked about Salem was that he likes cat things as well. Like, he's this really cynical person that's been like put into the body of a cat for trying to take over the world. And then at one point she's like, oh, do you want this little rubber mouse? And he's like, yes, please. You know, so I quite like that little thing. And anyway, so on with the episode. Hilda has a date with the head of the Witches Council, and he's like stood her up like 100 times before. And then Libby is winding up Jenny and Sabrina. Is it Jenny? Jenny? Her mate?
Yeah, the friend, yeah.
Yeah. And then someone said, the world will be a nicer place if everyone told the truth, but you can't stop people from lying. And then it's like, or can you, kind of thing. So Sabrina's making this potion. It's like everyone tells the truth potion. And this is like kind of a thing, you know, like when you're growing up and you think you know it all and you know how things should be. And you've got this kind of like, if everything was like how I think it should be, it's fine. And then this is where you actually get to see it go horribly wrong. You know, what you thought wasn't actually the best thing in the world. So they're all making a cake in a home economics, and she has these little sprinkles, and she sprinkles them all over the cake, like and when people eat them they tell the truth. And so she gives it to, the whole point is she wants to give it to Libby to find out what Libby was saying about her behind her back. And it turns out, you know, she's, I didn't write down what she said, but it wasn't very nice. But the teacher says, oh, your cake's that good, I'm going to give it to everyone in the class and all the teachers and things like that. This is when you get like, people shouldn't exactly tell the truth, because his guidance counselor's like, yeah, to be honest, I'm just here for the money and you're never going to make it anyway. So what's the point in even coming into school? So she kind of like hears this and realizes that, you know, maybe that's not the best thing in the world. And before that, Jenny and Sabrina said, like, you know, do you know what, I don't, Harvey had asked him out to go on like this not a date, because it's just like mates eating pizza or whatever, he's invited Jenny and Sabrina, and basically,
ooh, love rivalry there.
Yeah, so this is where it kind of like this little sort of mini love triangle thing starts. And I keep wanting to say Libby. So Jenny and Sabrina's like, oh, to be honest, I don't want to go. Like, you two can go if you want. He's like, no, I don't want to go if you're not there, kind of thing. And then when they have the potion, Jenny's like, to be honest, I want to go on my own because I fancy him, sort of thing. And then when they go, they start talking to Harvey and Jenny are there on their own. And they basically don't like each other. Just like, I like nature. He's like, I don't like nature. Sabrina comes in and she goes home and says, this has gone wrong. I shouldn't have done what I did. Everything's gone really bad. And then Zelda gives her some sprinkles and says that you've got to tell the truth now. And she goes to Harvey and says, do you know what? I wouldn't mind giving it a go. And I was bothered when you kind of did your thing. And it turns out that Zelda didn't even give her any true sprinkles. It was all herself. And then Hilda is about to go on a date with the guy from the Magic Council, and she stands him up instead. And that's the end of that episode.
Good for her.
I love the fact that this show, which is all about kind of which you think on face value is about escapism, because it's talking about a parallel world of supernaturalism, but it isn't, because it kind of gives you the false pretense that you're going to be taken out of the realities of worldly things, and then it smacks you in the face. Like, there's just so many moral teachings that are peppered throughout the show. It's like, oh, we're going to give you some life lessons here. You thought you escaped, but you're back on planet Earth now. And, you know, so like the whole aspect of truth, you know, the different areas about, you know, truth telling, like, you know, it has its pros and it has its cons. And it's like when you're about to hurt other people, then sometimes you have to do a balancing act. Like, I just, second, as I say, second time round when I watched the show, like I really appreciated like just the life lessons that you get from this. And it's also showing like how human nature is just very, very complicated. You've got your sets of emotions, you've got your different personalities. And then sometimes ultimately there's no real rights and wrongs, but it's just about how you kind of work things out, but through a kind of united friendship way. So through your loved ones, etc.
Nice. So did you watch anything from season two?
Next episode I watched was the last one of episode season three, the one where they go to Hawaii.
Season two, quick summary, was Sabrina turning 17 and she learns that she must earn her witch's license or otherwise lose her magic. And she neglects her aunt's warnings to study for the test to obtain the license, and she consequently fails. And then she has to attend witch boot camp to earn the chance to a makeup test. And she passes the makeup test, but she only receives a learner's permit. And then obviously that goes into season three, which I watched, the episode one, which was It's a Mad, 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 Mad season opener. So again, it's Sabrina, her love life all over the place, and she has to choose between Dashiell, who was played by Donald Faison, aka Turk from Scrubs, or Harvey. And obviously she gets her witching license, which means she'll have all the power and knowledge in the world. And because the kids do well in the exam, they get a dance on Friday and Sabrina gets to organize. And obviously Harvey and Dash are trying to ask her to the dance. And the principal is suggesting that Sabrina chooses Billy Jack as the theme for the dance. But I think she ends up going with Grease. And then Salem's playing internet chess with someone from Albania. And he's been like really rude and belligerent to this guy online. And yeah, she's going, and then Sabrina's obviously going to her ceremony that she's got her witch's license, but she has to do one more test. And obviously there is a catch that she has to learn a family secret. And obviously she'll get like clues throughout the series that she has to solve this family secret. And obviously Dash and Harvey are not messing, like waiting around for Sabrina to give her an answer. And so they're like, you know, look, you're going to have to choose one of us or we're not going to go with any of us. And so they're dueling Dash and Harvey for Sabrina's heart. And I think what happens is Harvey looks like he might get into something, and then Sabrina instantly saves Harvey. And Dash is like, look, you saved him, so you should go with him. And it's all good in the hood and whatnot. And Hilda sees the vice principal and she asks him out. And then obviously Yuri from Albania is here and he's confronting Salem. And then obviously Harvey asks Sabrina out if they could go steady. I think that was actually what he said. Can we go steady? And yeah, they get back together, and I'm sure that's how that story ends, but it doesn't, obviously, as we'll find out in the later series. And then take it away with the season three finale, Paul.
This is an episode that I remembered when I was watching this, because she has to solve this little family riddle, right? I think that goes throughout the series.
Yeah, it goes throughout the series.
And I remembered, well, as soon as I saw the little board that all the little clues were on, I remembered what the family secret was, so I was quite excited about that, to be honest. There's like this family reunion thing happening in Hawaii, and Salem got beat up by, he in his words, a woman, and it was like this cat that beat him up, and now this cat is having kittens with someone else, but he's decided that he's gonna look after the kittens.
So literally having kittens and not having kittens.
Literally having kittens.
I'm sure he's having a panic attack as well.
So, and at the same time, Harvey needs somewhere to stay. I don't know why. And obviously they're going to Hawaii, so he can stay at theirs. And he's got to look after the cats, because the cat's about to give birth and Salem's there. And she casts this Dr. Doolittle spell on him, which means that he can talk to Salem and it's not weird or something like that. So basically they're just like, they're just chilling and watching like football and sports, and like it's like, you get the pizza, I'll get the dip and whatever it is. So they're like, Salem and him are chilling, and this is where I've written down, so she needs to solve the family secret. Oh, they go to Hawaii and she gets locked in a room until she can solve the family secret. So I remember it as something about a twin. It's twine. She gets this ball of string. That's her clue. And then I've written down that it's twine, not string. And it says like minus E. And the thing is, every member of the Spellman something or other has a twin or something like that. And the whole reason they're there is that she can be reunited with her twin. And they have kind of this like montage of a good day, and they're doing this and doing that, and then they have to go to this trial where one of them's an evil twin, and they do this like montage of their lives to see who was the
most evil.
Yeah, exactly, who's the evil twin. So it's quite funny because when Sabrina's like thinking back of all the things she's used her magic for and all the things she's done, she's like, oh crap, am I evil? You know, like she thinks that maybe she's the evil one.
This feels like Judgment Day.
Yeah, it's literally, that's literally what it is, because the person that loses goes into the volcano. So,
oh wow! There's anyone watching this? I'm surprised there weren't too many conversions happening after. To what faith? Nobody knows, but yeah.
So basically, the first test is like he's going to ask you loads of questions, and you've got to answer them. And then this little dog comes along, and Sabrina's like, oh, are you lost? And he's asking questions to her, and he's like, I don't know what you said. He's like, I can't ask it again. And she goes, I don't know, yellow, get a question wrong. And then she asks again, she gets all three questions wrong, and the evil twin, I think it's called Katrina, gets all the questions right, but she loses the thing because the whole test was the dog and see if you'd care about the dog. So Sabrina wins the first one, and then it says, how have you used your magic in the last 24 hours? And then oh no, sorry, this is like a highlight reel of how you've used your magic, and basically Katrina wins that one because she's used it all to like save people. So she wins that round. So it's like kind of one all kind of thing. And then the real test is like how you've used your magic in the last 24 hours. And she used her magic to calm down the cat that was in labor. And when she only did that so that Salem would help her with the clue. So it wasn't noble kind of thing. And what she accidentally did was, because Harvey's mum was preggers as well, and she put kittens in Harvey's mum instead. So when they did like the listen to the heartbeat of the baby, they could hear like the purring of the cats. So she had to go back to the hospital to try and like kind of reverse this whole thing. When she goes back to the trial, she's lost. She loses because she's done it all with not a noble cause, and her punishment is that she gets to get pushed in the volcano by the other twin. So evil twin gets pushed in by the normal twin, and it turns out that the evil twin did push her in the volcano, and that's like the most evil act, and that was the final test. And no one's ever been pushed in the volcano before because but then I think Zelda zaps her out of it and she doesn't actually die. Then Salem has the cats. Oh, they have a hula lesson, blah, blah, blah. And then Salem has the kittens to look after. And when the kittens get taken to Harvey's house, you know, like kittens go, and then he just starts crying. but he gets to visit them every other weekend. And that was the end of the Series 3 finale.
Nice. So Series 4, it's all about Sabrina. She starts working at Bean There Brewed That, which is a coffee shop, and this is where she meets and is attracted to Josh, who is a college student and manager of the shop. And she cheats on Harvey with this Josh fella, and it ends up ending their relationship. And at the end of the season, Harvey reaches his spell quota, meaning that no spells can be used on him anymore. And he discovers that Sabrina is a witch. And he breaks up with Sabrina off screen and is written out of the show. I did watch No Place Like Home, the first episode, which was a really fun episode. So basically, Hilda and Zelda are upset that Sabrina might move out and things are going to change. And so Sabrina's dad wants her to move to Paris with him because he's going to like live a mortal life now, and he's not going to be going up and down the planets doing whatever he does. And Hilda and Zelda are upset, but obviously they understand that, look, that's her dad. And if he wants to like live with his daughter again, then they're not going to get in the way. And Harvey gets tickets to Britney Spears' concert. And obviously she's initially telling her dad, look, I don't want to move because of Harvey, senior year. And Brad comes back, who's like Harvey's best mate or whatever, but he's really hostile towards Sabrina for whatever reason. And someone called Valerie might be coming to stay, and Hilda and Zelda are getting rid of all of their magic potion. And they're like, oh, well, we're not going to do magic for like a year or whatever. And Mr. Kraft becomes principal, and Valerie changes her mind and she doesn't want to stay. Everything's going wrong for Sabrina, so she decides to go to Paris. And Harvey's feeling sad that Sabrina's gone, but every time like Sabrina's turning on the telly, she's seeing that Harvey was laughing, but obviously he was being tickled by someone and not laughing because he's having the time of his life. And so Salem's crying because of the drapes, but he's lying, he misses Sabrina. And so obviously she wants to see Britney Spears in concert, but she can't. So her dad brings Britney Spears to her, and Britney Spears was actually in this episode in the flesh.
You drive me crazy.
Yes, it was that song. And
it was that song. That's, by the way, a little bit of information revealing about my pop history. That was my favorite Britney song.
It's a cracking little song, I'm not gonna lie.
Yeah.
And so she's like singing with Britney, and they're doing their little dance or whatever, and they're having like the time of their life. And Britney's giving her advice, and obviously Britney's telling Sabrina, look, you're taking the easy way out, maybe you should kind of toughen up and things like that. Sabrina's dad,
so many life lessons.
Yeah. Sabrina's dad has to go to Pluto, so Sabrina decides to go back home. So yeah, Harvey's happy that Sabrina's back. They see Britney backstage, and Britney waves at Sabrina. And obviously in the You Drive Me Crazy video, Melissa Joan Hart is in the video. So one good turn deserves another, and whatnot. And season five, so Sabrina's starting college at Adams College, and she moves out of her aunt's house and into a house with other students. Her roommates are Morgan, Roxy, and Miles. And Hilda and Zelda are finding ways to stay close to her. So Hilda buys the coffee shop where Sabrina works, and Zelda becomes a professor at Adams, and she starts dating Sabrina's English professor. Season six, Josh and Sabrina get together, but they face a tough decision as Josh is tempted to move abroad to work as a photographer. Things are even more complicated when Harvey reappears, and he's dating Sabrina's roommate Morgan. And at the end of the sixth season, Sabrina agrees to sacrifice true love in order to save Hilda after the latter literally falls to pieces after Sabrina sabotages her relationship. Hilda recovers and is married, but Sabrina then falls to pieces when Josh, Harvey, and an attractive waiter announce that they are all moving away and will never see her again. And obviously, the final season, Sabrina is put back together after her aunt sacrifices her adult years to save Sabrina. And she meets Aaron, and they become engaged. So I can kind of talk about what a witch wants. So Sabrina is packing for her bachelorette cruise, and so it's left to Aaron, her fiance, to look after Salem. But she ends up being on a cruise with a bunch of old people. And, you know, we're seeing that Salem's trying to watch TV, but Aaron's like, get away, you stupid cat, and starts spraying the poor thing. And Sabrina starts to, like, wish for things, and she's wishing for, like, boys, good music. And R&B singer Mario was in this episode, and he plays the DJ.
Oh, my gosh, that's a blast from the past.
And Aaron, he locks up Salem in the cat basket. And obviously Sabrina, she's in the party or whatever, and she's having cold feet. And she's, you know, saying, I'm going to miss you guys. And she's wishing that, and she's obviously thinking, oh, I wonder if my friendship will survive. And they basically end up stranded in the Bahamas. And the girls are fighting and they're like, oh, well, our friendship isn't going to survive. I hate you guys. I'm not going to miss you guys. And while they were on there with the Australian footballers on the boat, they end up crashing into them and they come back home because Salem does a trick on Aaron. So he has to end up being bailed from the police station. And yeah, you could talk about soulmates, Paul.
Sabrina's getting married. No idea who the people were in her house. Aunt Hilda comes with a llama who's actually her mum. Zelda is a candle. So it turns out that the whole thing of... So her mum is going to be like turned into a ball of wax, right? If she sees Zelda... No, sorry, sees Sabrina. But I thought that was only a two-year thing. I swear this is like 7 years have gone by.
Yeah.
Continuity problem.
Yeah, so anyway, so to get around that, Zelda had to sacrifice herself and then be a candle. And I really didn't like this. I thought this was the last episode, man. Like, you could do some convincing, pay the money, get her in, you know. I thought, like, she was there for a while. So anyway, that annoyed me. Young girl goes and gets Harvey and she's magic. Magic's his bike. And so basically she's going to get Harvey because she's got cold feet, and she wants Harvey to be at the wedding. That's right. So she makes herself on the back of his bike, and then he's like, what the hell? And he crashes his bike. And then Sabrina goes into a room and there's a person in there, and it's actually like Doubt in human form. And he's been to the North Star and he's got Aaron's soul stone or something like that to see it, and it's basically seeing if it fits with Sabrina's soul stone, and it nearly fits.
I did write down the thing that Sabrina says before going to the North Star was, one place in heaven is always true. Help me to know before I say I do.
Yeah, I thought about writing it down. I look around for my pen. I'm like, nope, too far. So Salem tries to give it a talk, but gets cut off. Her fiance says, I don't know about all this soulmate stuff, but I do know I love you. Then the wedding begins. Sabrina's dad arrives for the wedding. She's kind of doing this, like, you know, I'll be there in 2 minutes. I'll be there in 2 minutes. I'll be there in 2 minutes. I'll be there in 2 minutes, the whole time. And everyone's kind of waiting on her. All the guests are there. And she starts walking down the aisle. And then she sees that she's got on a bracelet that Harvey gave her. And it's got like the time 12:36 or something like that. The time that they met. And then she kind of like bails again, leaves him kind of just standing there, and then Hilda kind of tells her, look, because Sabrina's like, the universe is against this wedding, blah blah blah, and she's like, no, the universe isn't against it, you're against it, that's why you don't want to do it, kind of thing. Then she goes down, and then she's walking down the aisle again, and she can't say the vows because it's like something about true love in the vows, and she's like, I can't say that. And then she stalls the wedding again. Then the wedding gets called off. And then he's like really cool about it. And they kind of like kiss and like, oh, it's okay. I would not be cool about that. I would not have taken it about him like calling the whole wedding off. I wouldn't. He was like, oh, yeah, so it's really good. I'll see you later. Bye.
I'd be like, you could have waited until like a pandemic was happening. And then at least like we just had like 15 guests in total or something.
But honestly, like, what do you expect him to do? Like, obviously, this is the bit where he realizes, look, we're not two halves of a whole. What?
Yeah, but I'll be like, listen, can you just go along with it for a little while? Because all of my friends and family here. It's embarrassing.
What can you do if someone doesn't love you and they just kind of come to the, you probably should, but then, you know, it's one of those things where if you're committing to someone for the rest of your life, I mean, I'm talking from a totally bloke perspective, by the way. So
yeah, I mean, he's probably committed thousands of dollars on it, and then she's like,
see, I'm with producer Paul right on this one. I just think there's always lawyers later on.
Yeah, exactly. And also, do you know, like, the people that, you know, you see them on the internet, I mean, it's a little bit funny in a morbid way, but when they like get a proposal and then the person just runs off in front of everybody and, you know, leaves a person standing there like, what the hell? You could at least say yes, walk off, and then be like, actually no, I just didn't want to embarrass you in front of the whole internet.
In front of the whole, but I don't know, I just, yeah, like, I can,
but you know what, I think the whole series has like culminated towards this one episode where, like, you know, she's literally been having all these life lessons. Be truthful, don't be truthful, manage your expectations, don't manage your expectations, like, you know, the balancing act. And then it's like come to this finale where she has to then put all her life lessons into this one big test, which is all about soulmates. And it's like, you know, this is the one thing I don't like, because, you know, like, having lived through my adult life now, I actually blame a lot of these shows for putting this false impression of soulmates, which do not exist. Sorry to burst anyone's bubble out there. There is someone out there for everyone. But I don't believe in soulmates.
I think that there's this idea that, you know, like, that love will conquer all kind of thing. And, you know, and really, you know, like, so basically at the end of the episode, Harvey's waiting outside on the bike, they kiss, they go away, and
No. Whoa. It's not just they just ride off into the sunset. There's something to this. They ride off at 12:36 precisely, because that was when they first met. They didn't just ride off into the sunset willy-nilly. Come on.
I'm disappointed it wasn't on a broomstick.
Yeah, I mean,
ride off into the motorbike, so... and they're playing hang on, I wrote the song down. Running by No Doubt.
What a great, you know, this show had all the best cultural pop elements.
Oh, NSYNC were in an episode as well, I read.
Yes, let's not forget them.
So, yeah, there was lots of that. And, yeah, they ride off at 12:36 p.m. Not just any random time.
But it's very romantic. But what I'm saying, what Nels was saying is, like, what I think you're saying is that, you know, like, what happens after that, you know, like,
yeah, like, it ends, you know. There's no such thing as happily ever after. Yeah, that, I mean, false misconception
when he doesn't pick his socks up and they get into a row for the first time, you know. So, like, you've got to work harder than just, like, you know, soulmates won't fix everything. You've got to work as well as not. And I think that's what, you know, what Aaron was saying, even in the episode. He's like, I don't know about the soulmate stuff, but I do love you. And
yeah,
you know.
No, I did like that when he said that. I did like that, because it's like, yeah, I don't know. Like, I love you. You love me. Whatever we can work on.
That would have been a winner, deal clincher for me.
Yeah, like, whatever we can work on, we can work on. Obviously, this Harvey fool is like, he's not serious. He's like backpacking all over America on his motorbike.
Yeah, exactly. And let's not forget, he rejected her when he found out she was a witch.
But to be fair, she did cheat on him as well. There is that, oh, yes, too.
I've forgotten that slight fact.
There is that, I mean, too. So, you know, I don't blame him.
Let's not tarnish the representation of Melissa, please.
I mean, it would have been a bit of an awkward episode if they'd come out and they would have got married.
But yes, the chilling adventures of Sabrina. So this is a dark coming-of-age story that includes horror and witchcraft. Sabrina Spellman must reconcile her dual nature as a half-witch, half-mortal, while fighting the evil forces that threaten her and her family and the daylight world humans inhabit. And for the first part of the first season, the review aggregator Rotten Tomatoes reported a 91% approval rating.
Really?
The website's consensus reads, and I quote, "Bewitchingly beautiful and wickedly macabre, Chilling Adventures of Sabrina casts an intoxicating spell and provides a perfect showcase for Kiernan Shipka's magical talents. With a stronger mystery steeped in witchy world building, Chilling Adventures remains a deliciously dark, delightfully camp romp that pushes Sabrina deeper down the path of night. If only she would get there a little faster." Exactly. You know how heavy weather it was to watch that first part?
Do you know, with the commendable wordplay in that description, I'm inclined to think some PR teams were involved in that.
I was thinking the same thing.
Your man from Archie Comic wrote that, didn't he? Yeah. Right, let me go on Rotten Tomatoes and write, yes, delightfully camp, deliciously wicked, please. You know how difficult it was for me to watch that first part? And it was an hour long as well. I'm like, you're killing me. An hour long, you're killing me. Like, I'm just watching that thinking, oh my God, just...
I don't think the show did not survive beyond series 3. I'm surprised it got to season 3.
Controversy. So in November 2018, Satanic Temple activists sued the series production team over the use of the statue of Baphomet, which they claim was a direct copy of their own statue and portrayed the temple in an inaccurate and derogatory way. Temple members were also concerned about the depiction of Satanists as cannibals practicing false worship. And it was confirmed that the Satanic Temple and Netflix have amicably settled their lawsuit dispute, with the terms of the deal being left undisclosed to the public. So basically, you devil worshippers, take your money and shut up.
There you go. Plagiarism in paganism.
Yes, it is, isn't it? No, I mean, this chilling Sabrina was, yeah, it wasn't for me. Continue watching? Nah,
definitely not. And even Melissa had her say, she was like, I'm just not going to get my kids to watch this. Scathing reviews.
She ain't going to get her kids to watch any of that.
Yes, there was a real disapproval look from her. She tried to keep it under check because she realized this is going out to the masses. And she's worldly enough to recognize that there's two parts of that type of ideology who support her. So,
I mean, I'd rather her, Melissa Joan Hart, to play Sabrina Spellman at whatever age she is now, as a grown-up self, then rather sit down and watch another episode of this.
What I'd like to see is it really happily ever after with soulmates? That's what I want to see. So I want to see the show continue and show Melissa in her current state, married to Harvey and potentially divorced to Harvey.
Why would she be divorced to Harvey?
This is real life, mate. Give us a slice of reality, I say.
Well, I mean, obviously Carissa's coming back, so I don't know if Sabrina could be tempted to bring back one of her shows. Maybe she can.
When is Clarissa coming back? I know we spoke about this last time, but I know, and I know in between there has been a pandemic, but I'm eagerly awaiting news about this.
No, I mean I don't. Yeah, like I said, it might be a case where production has been put on hold. I mean, they've put it on the shelf for the meantime and bring it back up.
They could always do a Zoom production.
I mean, I'm sure that's what everyone's doing nowadays, aren't they? So, yeah. Right, so to sum up, were there any final thoughts about Sabrina?
Only that I fully appreciated it once I got older. And I think I could watch it a third time round and fully appreciate it and maybe stop off by season 4 or 5 before the whole romance drama, will they, won't they, kind of kicks off. Because for me, the happily ever after is at the point when she's just about to go to college. So that's the perfect, the end.
What about you, Paul?
I thought this show, like you said, until like series 4 or whatever, was fairly harmless. It was a nice thing, little moral lessons, little bit of magic thrown in and a funny cat. I think it was easy to watch. I think it's stood up. I think it's, you know, as good now as it was then, probably. Like I said, I mean, HD hasn't done it any favours, but yeah, apart from that, it's good.
I liked it enough as a kid. I liked it again watching it. It was really fun, really harmless. I didn't like the theme song change. They should have just left it as it was. Like, obviously Sabrina's theme song is very iconic. It's very like takes me back to, you know, Saturday nights on ITV, and they changed it to whatever the hell they changed it to. And I think once it kind of became Sabrina the not so teenage witch, it kind of lost its way a little bit. But like the first few series were very, very adorable, very nice, and it was really good to watch. And we'll bring this bit to an end. And thank you so much for joining us and giving us all of that brilliant insight.
Thank you for having me. So thank you, Abdullah and producer Paul, for taking me down memory lane.
Well, you're more than welcome, and you're welcome any time. There's any TV show that we might talk about that you liked in particular, then you give us a shout and we'll get you back on. Yes, and thank you so much for joining us, and come back again soon.
Thank you. Bye-bye, guys.
Right, that was a really, really good chat about Sabrina the Teenage Witch. Of course, yeah, many thanks to Nabs Pats, and we definitely hope that she will be back with us soon. So now we're going on to The Worst Witch, and this show came out in October 1998, and some of the things happening in the world. Europol is established when the Europol Convention, signed by all of its member states, comes into force. General Augusto Pinochet, who was the Chilean dictator from 1973 to 1990, is indicted for human rights violations he committed in Chile by Spanish magistrate Baltasar Garzón. 6 days later, British police place him under house arrest during his medical treatment in the UK, and this is a leading case in the law of universal jurisdiction. Vladimir Putin became a permanent member of the Security Council of the Russian Federation. Ants was in the cinemas. And Girlfriend by Billy Piper was number one in the charts. This was actually quite a nice little song. I mean, she was in prominence because I think she was married to Lawrence Fox, and he turned out to be Chris Evans as well, yeah, the radio guy. But yeah, she was married and she divorced, thank God, that racist human garbage Lawrence Fox, and took her and her son to a Black Lives Matter rally. So I was like, yeah, Billie Piper, she's the one. So The Worst Witch. So this was originally a series of children's books written and illustrated by Jill Murphy. The series are primarily, it's about boarding school and fantasy stories, with 8 books published. The first, The Worst Witch, was published in 1974 by Allison and Busby. And the most recent first prize for The Worst Witch was published in 2018 by Puffin Books. It focuses on Mildred Hubble, who is a young witch who attends Miss Cackle's Academy for Witches, a school of magic. Although well-intentioned, Mildred's clumsy personality leads the girls to disastrous situations. She's thus considered the worst student in school, or the worst witch. And you've got the benevolent headmistress, Miss Cackle, who is generally understanding, whereas her form teacher, Miss Hardbroom, thinks she's just not trying hard enough. And Mildred's friends include Maud Spellbody, who is a rotund, sensible girl who's always trying to avoid confusion. Enid Nightshade, who is a practical joker, who is more than likely than Mildred to get them all in trouble. And the three girls have a strong rivalry with Ethel Hallow, who is a high-born, snobbish and vindictive classmate. The author Jill Murphy began writing The Worst Witch at the age of 15 while still at school, and based many points of the stories on her own school experiences at Ursuline Convent in Wimbledon. And singing became chanting, chemistry becoming potions, and so on. Recalling how she got the idea for the story, she said, "My two friends and I used to come home in our dark uniforms, looking very scruffy at the end of the day. My dark plaits, sprouting tufts with lost hair ribbons. And my mom used to say, 'Look at you all. You look like three witches,' and it gave me the idea for a witches school, so that it was exactly like my school with a subtle touch of magic, and all the characters are based on my school friends and enemies and teachers." And Murphy had concluded the first book at the age of 18, but failed to achieve a publishing deal, causing her to put it on a drawer. And after working as a nanny in a children's home, she got a phone call from a small publisher interested in the book, and The Worst Witch was finally published in 1974 when Murphy was 24 years old. And the TV version was on ITV, and it was obviously revolved around the school following the adventures of Mildred and her friends. And the series was later followed by The New Worst Witch, which ran for 2 series and chronicled the experiences of Mildred's younger cousin, Hetty, as she attended school. In 1999, the series was nominated by the Royal Television Society for Best Children's Drama. In 2000, Georgina Sherrington won the Young Artist Award for Best Performance in a TV Comedy Series. Some of the characters of the TV show, so obviously Mildred Hubble, she's a clumsy, bungling witch in training who never seems to get anything right. Ethel Hallow, She's a straight A student, comes from a prominent and historic witch family, and gives the impression of being a model student to her classmates. Maud is a short girl with wide glasses and stringy hair that she wears in bunches, and she's fiercely loyal to Mildred and her sister on most of her adventures, often against her better judgment. Enid is a small, waif-like girl, and at first Mildred thinks she will simply be a nuisance. However, Enid turns out to be a wild, practical joker whose attempts to make Mildred like her. Drusilla Paddock is Ethel's best and only friend, and she's a vindictive bully but lacks the acid-tongued spite of Ethel. Ruby, who is very loyal to her friends and keen to learn at Cackle Academy, she's also heavily addicted to all kinds of electronic contrivances and therefore a thorn in the flesh of old-fashioned Miss Hardbroom. Jadu Wally, who is another one of Mildred's close friends, and she's mostly very sensible, and during the first 2 years, she's of a rather meek nature, but she gets dragged along whatever crazy crusade Mildred and the others are going on. Miss Cackle is the headmistress of Cackle's Academy, and she's often wary of Mildred's exploits, but ultimately she's much more fairer and much more sympathetic than Miss Hardbroom. Miss Constance Hardbroom is the fearsome deputy headmistress of Cackle's Academy. Tall and scrawny and sour-faced, she strikes fear into the students' hearts and seems to have a particular resentment for Mildred. And Miss Davina Batt, who was played by Una Stubbs, aka Aunt Sally in Wurzel Gummidge, she lives in the stationery cupboard in the staff room and has a habit of eating bizarre foods. So, the worst witch.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely remember this show. I didn't really remember any particular episodes, but I definitely watched this when I was when I was younger. It was. I mean, Ethel's horrible. She was like really, really nasty. It's kind of like, you know, that thing at school where you always get that person that's like, you know, the rich person who's a real one, you know.
I didn't really like this show. I thought it was very tough to watch. I too also remember this show as a kid. I remember giving it a very, very, very wide berth as a kid and thinking, nah, this show's not really for me. And I would watch other things on CBBC at the time. And yeah, just even watching it now, I thought it was okay. No, not even okay. I didn't really particularly like it. I did appreciate the diverse cast. So you had Ruby and Jadu, black girl and an Asian girl. Nothing wrong with that. I like that a lot about this show. And I appreciated that they did that in 98 or 97, whenever this show came out. But yeah, other than that, I wasn't really...
One thing I think you got to give credit for is the sets. Like, you know, this is before, you know, obviously there was some like blue screen, green screen stuff going on. But, you know, the sets were quite decent for their time. You know, you couldn't fake a lot of the stuff. It was like you had the set or you didn't have the set, you know. And I quite liked that it was dressed. Again, I mentioned this before, but about, like, you know, Harry Potter being this kind of giving birth to that, because, you know, like, when we were growing up, I think this was only a couple of years until Harry Potter's first book came out.
I think Harry Potter came out well before this show. I think Harry Potter, came out in I think the first book might have been released in like 94 or 95 or something. Or it might have actually been released in 91. Because that was when, obviously, Harry first goes to Hogwarts, was 1991.
Hang on a minute. You might be right. So, hang on. Philosopher's Stone was 97, so it's only a year. So, maybe...
Yeah, there you go, yeah.
So the appetite had already been whetting, kind of thing. But I think it's because I didn't read the books until I went to secondary school.
It was only when the Goblet of Fire had came out where everybody... Because, obviously, the first three books just kind of went unnoticed, like, huh? Harry Potter? What? It was only when the fourth book came out. And then I think that's when they said, right, we're going to make movies.
Yeah.
That was when it kind of went and it kind of took a mind of its own and kind of grew exponentially from that. But prior to that, it was nothing.
Yeah, I remember this. You saying that, I do remember this being in primary school and someone of my, one of my friends having the book and reading it. And, I wasn't interested at first, but yeah. Anyway, back to this show. I thought it was a pretty decent, like, thing. One thing what was strange is, you know, the whole thing is that she's a bit useless, but she's got, you know, some qualities that, you know, kind of keep saving her and things like this. But to be honest, I was with Miss Hardbroom. I would be like, you ain't right here. So I'll see you later. Because it gets to a point and you have to say, it's not working out. You know, like if I was training someone to do something for me and they were that useless, I'd be like, obviously, you can't go through life thinking that, you know, you can do everything and, you know, everything's for you. You have to kind of recognize that actually sometimes that's not for you. You know, make way for someone that does, or go and do something you are good at, or, you know, I'm not saying that if you were without practice, you couldn't, like, you know, manage to do a few things, but I think you do have to recognize your limitations sometimes, something that Mildred Hubble did not do.
I think you just summed up white privilege there in a nutshell.
Really?
And what it's like to be white. Yeah, you can try anything and you can do anything in the world and nobody's ever going to tell you that you can't really do that.
No, I think it's important to understand, like, you know, don't you have to, like, manage your expectations, like, sometimes. Like, say if you're like if you're someone that, like, is no good at maths and science and things like that academic wise, I mean, you probably should be telling, like, you ain't going to be an astronaut, because you need to be good at those things. I mean, I was like, I remember when we did our career aptitude test and it's like, you know, it comes up with these weird rubbish jobs, office things and things like that, and working in television wasn't on my radar at that point. And I was rubbish at everything at school. I did not excel at anything. I didn't get one. The closest mark I got to anything was a B in sports studies when I was doing my GCSEs. That's the highest mark I got. And then when I turned to like vocational subjects, I excelled and I started getting A's and I started, like, getting distinctions and you know, really good marks. So when I actually did something that I found my vocation, I excelled. But the rest of it, I wish someone just said, like, you know, don't bother coming to A-levels because you won't do well. And I went to A-levels and I didn't do well. I wasted 2 years of my life doing A-levels. I walked away with one E, you know? So the rest of it, I literally, like, flunked the other three subjects I was taking. So
what was I going to say? Yeah, so it's just a case of you're not suited for the rage of war. So pack up, go home, you're through. How can I make a witch out of you. Yes, that's what they should have said to her. So let's talk about episodes.
Right, so obviously I watched the first. So full disclosure, I watched two episodes of the original. And then I went on to the Netflix re-release series brought out in 2017, was it? 2017? I watched the trailer for it first. And I was like, this looks total garbage. And I'll come on to what I actually thought about it afterwards. Anyway, so
the Battle of the Broomsticks.
Yeah, so this was like first day of school. You know, everyone's like, one thing I've got to give it credit for, it does give it that year seven feel about it. You know, like, new school, bit scary, other kids. And so basically Mildred's on her way to school and she bumps into this nasty girl, Ethel. And Mildred maybe accidentally knocks her off because she's like showing off. She's on, I've been riding my broom for ages and I can do this. And Mildred can't ride her broom. She's struggling. And Mildred kind of like pulls this tree back and it kind of flings back and smacks her off a broom. And she's like, oh, you did that on purpose. Blah, blah, blah. So what happened is, like, Ethel goes thing and Mildred's going to be late and they're kind of doing like the roll call thing and Mildred's late and they've locked her out. They locked the doors and so she's like, crap, I'm going to have to fly my broom. She flies over the broom. So she flies over the wall with her broomstick and she kind of crashes and Mrs. Hardbroom's really nasty about it. Like, what the hell is going on here? Not even like concerned that she might be hurt. And Mrs. Hardbroom, like, from the very second, she likes Ethel, like this, like, kind of elite thing, but she's like, she's horrible to Mildred, like the, you know, the slightly useless girl. So she Mildred's in class and all she does is like open this book and she gets told off and she has to write, and then later on she has to write 500 times, "I must take care of my personal appearance," which I thought was like a bit horrible. And they have to do this kind of aptitude test where, you know, they've got like broomstick shenanigans going on where they've got to like go up here, hang this on here, fly through this and ring the bell and do this and that. Mildred's having a, because Mildred's like, she's scared of heights and she's really struggling with it. So she falls off a broom, and if they fail, they've got to go home. And meanwhile, the teachers have made this like flight simulator VR thing, and she's allowed to like try it again tomorrow, or the trials the next day. And they go onto the VR thing at night time, and they kind of sneak down and take it, and it kind of like starts flying around and going crazy. And then they get saved by Mrs. Hardbroom. She's actually against the VR thing. She's like, think you should do the real thing or don't do it at all. She gets one more chance because of the head teacher. She's head teacher's from a non-witch background as well, I think. Might have made that up. Oh, no, this is where you learn that Mildred is from a non-witch background. So she's been kind of selected. They do like this whole, like, this thing where you get witches and you get like people from a, like, it's kind of like positive discrimination where they, you know, they pick someone from a non-witch background to join the program kind of thing. Then another girl, looks like Moaning Myrtle, says it's because she's scared of heights and she just needs to get used to it. Oh yeah, because the next day she crashes off the thing again. Eventually she does it, even Mildred. And yeah, this is when I just wrote. So basically, eventually she manages to do it. She manages to do the salt course on the broomstick. And this is where I've written down, I'm with Mrs. Hardbroom. Like, she was not, like, if you fail the aptitude test, then, you know, where do you draw the line? Like, I know this is sound really harsh, but you got to agree with me. She wasn't cut out for witching.
Is that, and that's the first episode? That's so what other episode. What's the second episode you watched?
Second episode I watched was series 1, episode 13. I think this is must.
I watched that too. A Bolt from the Blue. So yeah, it's nearly the end of the year for the student witches, and Mildred's incantations still don't seem to work as intended, and they have to try and cure a case of hay fever brought on by one of Mildred's errors. The other teachers give her. They give Miss Cackle what they thought was a remedy potion, but it's actually a mislabeled experiment of Miss Hardbroom's, and the other teachers make no mentions of the mishap, even when Miss Cackle's behavior takes a turn for the worst. She's actually started being really hostile towards Mildred, because obviously normally she's quite sympathetic to Mildred. She's like, oh, okay, I kind of understand. But then she's like, why are you so useless? You're a useless, clumsy so-and-so. And she basically says, you know what? I'm going to expel her. And she's like, right, it's done. Right? I'm done with this girl. It's over. And everyone's shocked. And basically, Mildred and everyone realize it's not Miss Cackle, but it's her evil twin sister, Agatha, who has come back to cause more trouble. And they track down the real Miss Cackle to the store cupboard. And that is where Mildred and Enid were once trapped. And they're basically discovered by Agatha's two cronies, Coldstone and Bindweed. And time is ticking away. And yeah, the final confrontation takes place and Mildred saves the day. And she actually earns a raise in her final grade from C-. Surely that would just be C+.
Or C minus.
No, but two minuses make a plus.
Well, C then, surely. C, you got C plus, C minus, right? One either way.
But it's like C minus, minus. From C minus, minus to A plus. I'm not saying it's going to be A plus, but it's like C minus, minus will just become...
C minus, or C.
Whatever. Yeah, whatever.
I just want to go back, because actually I think the last confrontation was really cool. So the whole time when you get in there, it's like Agatha is talking to the crony saying, oh, I knew what you was going to do. I knew you was going to do this. I knew you was going to do that. And then it turns out it was Miss Cackle the whole time and had already captured Agatha. I thought that was like quite a cool little twist. I didn't see that coming. I was like, that's really cool.
I did like, though, that Mildred was getting like good grades in jewelry design and myths and legends.
Yeah. So she was getting all like the mortal subjects or whatever, the mortal realm subject. She was really good at. She, like, academic wise, she was smashing it out of the park. Just with the witching bit, she was rubbish. The next episode I watched was obviously the hour long new one.
Okay, so I watched two more episodes against my better judgment. So I watched season 2, episode 15, which was called The Inspector Calls. And much to my great disappointment, it had nothing to do with the play called An Inspector Calls.
Which is rubbish. Don't go watch it. I didn't understand
what, An Inspector Calls?
Yeah.
Inspector Calls is amazing.
No, do you know what? I had to ask a steward when I went to see that play. And I went outside and I was like, what was that show about?
So you never so you didn't do it in school?
No, I didn't study
it. Inspector Calls is amazing.
Nah, what is it even about?
It's about basically a girl. It's about a girl who commits suicide because she's basically had a rough time of it. And it basically involves a family. Like, they've had interaction with this girl. And at one point in her life, and it kind of, and they all did something to this girl. And it kind of contributed to her, you know, killing herself. And so, like, for example, the dad fires her because she was part of a military campaign or whatever. Not militant, but, like, you know, she was standing up for workers' rights or whatever. And so the dad fires her. The mom ran into her because... Oh, no. And then she runs into the daughter, who basically gets her fired from a job because she said that she looked prettier than her. Then the daughter's fiancé, he has her as a mistress, and she ends up, like, leaving because she doesn't want to stay there. She gets involved with the son, and he gets her pregnant. And then... at the last point of call, where she's like, I've got nowhere to go, she goes to a charity where the mum works, and the mum turns her down. And obviously, she's at her wit's end. And obviously, the inspector was a fake inspector, because when he leaves, the real inspector comes, and he's basically like, yeah, a girl's just committed suicide in the infirmary. So while all that time, that's the thing that I had an issue with in Inspector Calls. They had all of that time, all of that time to try and save that girl, yet you got this stupid ass inspector trying to teach them morals and right and wrong. You could have saved that girl's life. And then obviously that's how it ends, where it's like a girl has committed suicide in the infirmary. An inspector will be coming along shortly. And they're like, obviously, what the hell are you talking about? An inspector's coming along. We didn't spoke to an inspector.
That's why when I walked out of the theatre in the West End, I was like, I just don't know what's going on. I think it was at the I should come in what theatre it is. It's one near Embankment, I think.
Yeah. And Inspector Calls was amazing. I will not have no Inspector Calls slander here. So anyway, the episode. So there is a school inspector off witch who are coming along to inspect the school. And the particular individual appointed to inspect Cackle's Academy is none other than Mistress Hecate Broomhead, who is a tyrant. And she was Miss Hardbroom's personal tutor from Witch Training College. And so an emergency plan of action is drawn up. And in order to prevent any unforeseen disasters, they decide to banish Mildred. Because they're like, yeah, we ain't going to show you to no inspector. We don't want to... we don't want the school to shut down and we all go and get in trouble. So they basically keep Mildred out of sight. And then... basically, they're trying to impress. And there's a little girl called Sybil and she's trying to impress Mildred. And they basically... two girls are telling her that there's a bat hidden and their bats belong to Mildred and you can try and save her. And Mistress Broomhead is bent. She's like, she wants to close down the school because she does the inspection. And like, I like that they had like all this stuff written on the board to like cupboard, blackboard, wardrobe. And then obviously she's like, is it necessary for you to have these signs? Like, y'all know where the cupboard is, right? Y'all know this is a blackboard, right? Why are you writing it down? What's the point of that? And then obviously, you know what? You guys have failed. And then she turns around going, you know who I want to see? I want to see a girl called Mildred Hubble. Where the hell is Mildred Hubble? And so obviously all the teachers are like, okay, we've got to try and find her. And then, yeah, and those basically they cast a spell on Broomhead, and she's forced to change her mind. And yeah, the school is saved from closure. Yay! And then I watched the finale, which was The Uninvited. And Mildred and Jadu have been suspended from the school because I think they basically run a newspaper, and there was like a massive rebellion that kind of went wrong. And so they have to copy out chapters of the Historica Magica book. And Maud decides that she will run for head girl in order to get Mildred and Jadu reinstated. And the girls have the idea that if Mildred had the opportunity to save the school from destruction, as she has done before, then this would, you know, count in her favor to Miss Cackle. And then they decide to summon a mythical monster from the book called the Mythiocopia, with the intention that Mildred and Jadu can save the day. But it obviously goes horribly wrong when they summon the Uninvited, who is an evil witch who sets about putting everyone in the castle into a deep sleep. And Mildred has been sketching Prince Percy, who is a historical character from the book she's copying out to help pass the time. And she then discovers that she has the ability to bring her drawings to life. And once hearing about the Uninvited, Mildred brings her drawing of Prince Percy to life. And Mildred, Jadu, and Drusilla then use Prince Percy to wake everyone up who has been put to sleep with a single kiss to the lips. Not sure about that. And after waking Miss Hardbroom, they proceed to the Great Hall where the Uninvited has just put Miss Crotchet to sleep. And I think she was the one who replaced Miss Bat. And Miss Hardbroom battles the evil witch, but is overpowered and is left to Mildred to save the day by returning the Uninvited to the Mythiocopia using her special ability. And later at the head girl election on Maud's request, Miss Cackle makes Mildred head girl and Jadu deputy head girl in recognition of their efforts in saving the academy once again. Yay! And The Worst Witch in 2017 was the fifth adaptation of the Worst Witch series after the 1986 television film, the 98 television series, and the 2001 and 2005 TV spin-off shows. And it was an international co-production between CBBC, ZDF, and Netflix. I can tell you that I also didn't like this version. I don't think I even finished the episode. It was, again, a really, really tough watch. Found it really boring, really forgettable. And, yeah, you can talk about it, seeing as you watched probably more than I did.
So I watched the first one, the first hour episode. And do you know what? I watched the trailer and thought it was going to be garbage. And I started watching it and it wasn't half bad. I liked this way more than I liked the BBC production.
You mean the ITV production?
The ITV production. I thought this was great. And, you know, a little bit stupid, a little bit aimed more towards younger people, but I'm talking maybe like, you know, like proper children. Now this is probably aimed towards. But I genuinely thought this was quite a nice little easy enough to watch show. So starts off and Mildred's at home and she's like painting, and she can see, she lives in like some London skyrise thing, and she can see, I think it's London they live, maybe somewhere else. Anyway, she can see out onto the hills and she can see a castle, and she's kind of painting a castle, and her mum comes in and says, oh, you know, what are you doing? And she's like, oh, I like that you can do, you can draw things like that. And then she kind of sees these witches go screaming past the window on their broomsticks, and she goes outside and she gets hit by this little girl. It's Maud in the end, but little witch. She gets hit by her and she's lost her glasses. And they go down outside onto the grass because they live in a tower block. And this woman comes up and she says, like, what are you doing? And she says, oh, I'm helping her find her glasses. And she's like, help who find her? Whose glasses? And it turns out that mortal people can't see magical people. So obviously Mildred has to have some magic inside her because Otherwise, you wouldn't be able to see this girl. And then randomly, this girl says, this girl's glasses are knackered, so she can't see. And Mildred says, don't worry, I'll be your eyes. We'll both go on the broom and we'll go to the place. And so they go to the magic castle to do the things. And Mildred like blags her in. It's really like bit daft because she's like, oh, she was going to go to the other school, but she thought she'd try here first. And they're like, oh, okay, I'll put your name down on the list. As if admissions is that easy. Anyway, so they're kind of having this thing, this tour. They go into the kitten room. Mildred and Maud kind of like go off on the side into the kitten room, and Ethel, the horrible girl, she's still in it being horrible as usual. Kind of tells she hears them talking about how she's not a witch, and they go to they're late for the so one of the kittens escapes. They go to the kitchen, and Real Miss Cackle comes in, then Evil Twin comes in, so they already see the Evil Twin thing going on. Then they have to go back and do the test. Mildred gets 1%, everyone else laughs at her. A lot of people fail, though. It's not just Mildred being crap here. It's quite a lot of people. It's like 7 or 8 people that are, you know, get fail the test. Ethel obviously gets 100%. Agatha is doing an interview with Mrs. Harbour because she's writing a article for a website or something. They have to do like a practical test. Mildred needs some ingredient to make a potion, and Ethel comes in and nicks all of it off her. So basically Mildred nicks it back off her. When Ethel takes her potion, it's meant to make herself into a dragon, she turns into a worm. Mildred said, oh, I actually sabotaged your potion. And then there's like this kind of I am Spartacus thing going on, where Maud's like, oh, it's my fault. And Mildred's like, oh, it's my fault. And there's another girl's like, oh, it's my fault. I didn't care, to be honest. I was like, whoever, just kick them all out, you know. And then the teacher says Ethel should have double checked, but because Mildred meddled in someone else's potion, she gets an automatic fail. So basically they get kicked out of school. And then one thing I was like, Maud's crying, so like, oh, I'm gonna miss you so much, and they're all crying, and I was like, you've only known each other for 5 minutes, so you literally met each other this morning, like it ain't gonna be that bad, just give over. Anyway, Mrs. Cackle appears. I suspect it's Agatha at this point. Mildred realizes it's not her, but she gets booted out. But she, before that, she sees Agatha putting something in a soup, and she's making like a total devotion spell or something like that. So they're having a thing, and what's going to happen is the Real Miss Cackle's going to drink the soup. Agatha's going to say, now give this call to me. She's going to say, okay. But meanwhile, Mildred's making a potion out of the some ingredients she found at the pond, like in their real state, instead of letting little pots, she actually finds them for real. Then she flies through the window, knocks the soup out of Mrs. Cackle's thing. Agatha says, oh, it's true, I was going to take over the whole school. And then Agatha and Mrs. Cackle actually have like a wizard's duel. Agatha actually bests Mrs. Cackle, and then she said, I think her name's Ada, but anyway, so, and then basically they said that all of when Agatha wins, she's like the leader of the school. Mrs. Hardbroom like devotes herself to her. She's like, okay, I'm going to be like your thing, I accept that you're the leader now. And then she says, like, everyone in the school is bound by the witch's code, so you can't do anything about this. And she's looking at Mildred, who's like standing in the wings. She said, everyone who's in this school is bound by the witch's code and can't do anything. And she looks at her again, everyone in this school. And obviously she's been kicked out of school, so she's not in the school. So then she knocks over the soup, and it spills on her. It goes in Agatha's mouth, and then she says, because the first person to give a command is the one that they listen to. She said, like, who's going to listen to me? Who's going to help me get her out? And then Agatha says, I will help you get me out of this school. And then she goes away. Mrs. Cackle wins, and she gets to stay in the school. I know it's quite a long episode, but I genuinely really liked it. I thought it was quite a cool episode. I know you right now you're looking at me, you look so bored. But honestly,
I'm like, sorry, man. I couldn't mess with The Worst Witch. I couldn't get into the show. I mean, it is what it is, but I don't know. I don't know what else to say, man. It's just,
yeah, I thought this was really good. I thought production values are great. I thought it was like little, you know, a little bit innocent.
Yeah, it looked pretty slick and on point on the newer version of the show. And I watched the sum of episode two, I think, where they have to like pick cats. I think I made it to past the halfway point. I was like, I'm going to bed. I can't physically watch any more of this. I just cannot. And that is how I felt about that show. But I didn't feel the same about the next show that we're going to do. And finally, we're coming on to Belfry Witches. And this show came out in September 1999 again. So some of the things happening in the world. Sega publicly distributed their final video game system in North America, which was the Dreamcast, with 19 launch titles, breaking video game and entertainment sales records in the first 24 hours. Kiribati, Nauru, and Tonga, one of y'all baby listening to my damn podcast, the amount of times I said your country, join the United Nations. Serena Williams wins her first Grand Slam title by beating the world number one Martina Hingis in the US Open. American Beauty was in the cinemas, and Eiffel 65's Blue Dabadi was number one in the charts.
That's 3 for 3 today. Unexpected, but wow.
So it's a rare collector's item, that, your 3 for 3. So yes, the Belfry Witches. So this show was based on the children's book series by author and journalist Kate Saunders. It follows two witches, Skirty Mom and Old Noshi, as they cause mischief in a quiet English village named Tranter's End, which they fled to after being banished from their home on Witch Island. Yeah, it revolves around the two witches, and they are basically staying in a belfry, and they're with Chris Tucker, who is the resident naughty boy, a nasty woman called Mrs. Bag Meanly. I didn't know it was a double-barreled name. I thought it was Bag Meanly, one word. So it's a double barrel. And the head witch who was banished... Oh, the head witch who banished Skirty Mom and Old Noshi, her name is Mrs. Abercrombie. And the theme song was performed by Atomic Kitten. Something Spooky. I actually really liked it. It was very catchy. I remember this as a kid. That's why I remember this. It's a very iconic theme song. And obviously a bit about the two characters. Skirty Mom. She's one of the main characters of the show. She fancies herself to be the brains of the double act, but she's not. And she's not as clever as she thinks. And her brilliant ideas usually lead her and Old Noshi into trouble. Skirty's favorite foods are spiders, but she also eats bats and worms from time to time. It's hard to miss Skirty Mom, as she has a great talent for grabbing the spotlight. And despite being a witch, she tries to be good and secretly admires the way that humans act, as she spends loads of time trying to explain humans to Noshi, but her explanations are normally wrong. Skirty is incredibly vain and worryingly impulsive, but she is intensely loyal to her friends. Old Noshi, she's nearly 200 years old, but this is young for witches on Witch Island, and she's regarded as a big kid. Old Noshi loves to eat newts and bugs, and she's rather gormless and usually happy to be led by her brighter friend. She has moments of independence, however, and often gets annoyed with Noshi when she isn't treated as equal. She also has a broomstick that never does what it's told and isn't pleased that she got a cheap broomstick, and Skirty Mom got one of the finest twigs. And beneath her ragged exterior, she has a kind heart and is very well concealed sentimental streak. And she loves a joke, especially if it's a bit vulgar. And quick note on Laura Sadler, who played Skirty Mom. She was also pupil Judy Jeffries in the on Grange Hill. And she played Nurse Sandy Harper in Holby City. In the early hours of the 15th of June 2003, she fell 40 feet from the balcony of her Holland Park flat of her boyfriend and Holby City colleague George Khalil. She had consumed a large quantity of alcohol and was later found to have had traces of diazepam and cocaine derivatives in her blood. She suffered severe head injuries and never regained consciousness, and her family decided to take her off life support a few days later, and she died in Charing Cross Hospital a day later. Her character had continued to appear in pre-recorded episodes of Holby City for a while after her death, and her mother aided the show's writers in conceiving an exit storyline for Sadler's character, and she was revealed to have won the lottery and subsequently emigrated to Australia. I actually remember the Grange Hill episode where Julie Jeffries falls off a burning building and she dies. I think it might have actually been the first time I watched a TV program where somebody like died, like a death on TV. I think it was one of the very, very first, if not the first. So yeah, it was quite a significant thing in my childhood. And yeah, it was a very tragic ending because she was obviously a very talented actress. She was only 22 when she died, so still very, very, very young. No age at all. So let's talk about the Belfry Witches.
I never heard of this show. No, that's not true. I had heard of it, and I think maybe at some point I'd seen it, but I really struggled with this show. The first episode was like a chore to watch. One thing I did know, because it had, was it Lucy Davis in it, who plays Dawn in The Office?
And she also plays Hilda in the new Chilling Adventures of Sabrina.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, I didn't know that. So I'm a big fan of her because I really enjoyed The Office. And but one thing I noticed, what year did this come out? 99, right?
Yeah.
And I think The Office came out in 2004.
Something like that.
Right. And I thought, let me just check that fact, actually. Oh, couldn't have done, surely. 2001?
Yeah, I was going to say it was earlier than 2001.
So she did this 2 years later? 2 years later, she played this thing and she plays like this. Yeah, I mean, she looks very young. She looks very young in this. So that's what I was thinking. I was like, wow, like that's not a lot of time because she plays such an incredible role in The Office, that this one was just looked like some stupid little kids show compared with that. So, I mean, that sounded a bit harsh, but...
Very.
Sort of meant it as well. That's what the worst bit. anyway, do you want to say anything good about it? Because...
I do want to say something good about it. I mean, like I said, I really like the theme song. Very, very catchy. Shout out to Atomic Kitten. We've talked about them often on this podcast. And one day we would love to talk to the members of Atomic Kitten. But yeah, I thought it was a really fun show. I thought it was really wacky, really goofy. I enjoyed it very, very. I genuinely enjoyed the show. Enjoyed it. I mean, again, I might give it away, but I enjoyed this a hell of a lot more than I enjoyed The Worst Witch. It didn't take itself seriously. It was very silly. It was very goofy. It was clearly very fake with the whole flying and I'm the witches. And when they're doing their stupid little spells going blue and yellow, pink and green, turn this person to be less mean. So it would just be really daft things like that. I liked it. I thought it was very goofy and wacky. But the right kind of goofy and wacky.
Yeah, for me, it was just like the opposite. I was just like, this is not a decent thing. I don't even know why it was a thing. Like I said, the first episode in particular for me was an absolute chore. I mean, I tried to watch three episodes. I got to 2.5 episodes of this. And you know what? Like, you know, it was... The last two episodes I watched were okay. They were okay. You know, I particularly liked, I've forgotten his name, the old vicar guy was quite funny.
Harold
and Mrs. Bagmeanly, is that what you said?
Bagmeanly, yeah.
She was funny. I liked her and Harold, but yeah, I mean.
Right, yeah, let's might as well just go into episodes. The bad thing I will say was, yeah, the audio was terrible on this for a couple of the episodes. I had to like, because obviously I had problems with the right side of my hearing for quite a bit now. And obviously I had to like switch headphones because obviously the sound was coming out of this side. And I'm like, I can't hear nothing. What? So yeah, the pilot. Yeah, go for it.
So basically this is set in like some witches,
Witch Island.
Witch Island. And it's kind of like this like little bit where all the witches are like, it's the same thing. They're at school. They're learning things and they're kind of doing this thing, right? So there's two witches going around London. They're causing mischief and they go to this village. This boy's letting his tires down. They make the wheels disappear. They're playing knock and run, but on broomsticks. They start egging places. I think it's because it's Halloween. Anyway, so they're late for assembly at their school. So they go back to school. The boy that was letting the tires down has got blamed for it. So the policeman's like, no, I've just had the policeman knock at the door. He said, where is old mate his wheels? And he's like, I don't know. He's like, that's it, you're grounded.
They did not talk like that, all right? Not every policeman talks like that with a funny voice on, yeah.
So there's an assembly and Queen Abercrombie comes in and they're doing some like weird ritual. And they're just like messing about in assembly. And then they get told off by the Queen and they get banned from the ball. And then they get sent to their caves and I think they differentiate the years by the stocking, the color of their stockings. Yeah.
So they were red stockings.
Yeah. So they decide to dye them green, which I thought was quite clever. And then they go to the Halloween ball, but then they make mischief again. They start doing like naughty things and then they get caught. And obviously they're going to get caught. And I think they knock her wig off, right?
Yeah.
And yeah. They get in trouble for it because like they embarrass her. And then they get put in some sort of jail cell. They get put on trial for which was what they said, like the worst crime ever. Like no one's ever done this before. So we don't even know what your punishment's going to be kind of thing. So anyway, they end up getting banished for like, was it 100
years? Whoa, you forgot the trial. So like the cat is like the star witness and they're like, oh, tell them what they did. And the cat's just going, meow, meow. Yeah, I like that. I was like, oh, God.
So the cat gets brought as a witness. Everyone finds him guilty. Their punishment is they get banished for 100 years. The Queen makes a storm come after they get pushed off a cliff.
I don't get that. You've banished them, so let them be banished. You don't have to like try and... It's like, you know, in the bit in The Lion King where they're like to Simba, like, oh, run away, Simba, and never come back. And then he's like to the hyenas, kill him. Like, why you want to go and do that?
Well, he manages to get away in the end and he comes back and defeats Scar. Spoiler alert. So they go back to the village where they cause mischief and they go and live in the Belfry, which is like, hence the Belfry witches, right? So they're in the bell tower and the Queen summons the broomsticks back to her. And that was like the end of the first episode, I think. And that was like, you know, first episode done. Oof. Like the bit where they're in Witch's Island, I hated it. It was awful. Like the set was crap. The acting was crap. Like it was dark and the dialogue was crap. And I was like, this is just so boring. Like the bit where they were flying around the village was okay. And the bit where they're like interacting with like normal places was okay. But the bit where in the set, it looked total rubbish. And I was like, oh man, like, I can't believe this is like, this got a,
it didn't last long, did it? Got axed after two seasons.
I mean, I was expecting like the Chuckle Brothers to come out and start like doing a game show in it. The set was that bad, you know.
I mean, look, it was all of those things that you're saying. It kind of made me like it. It was just one of those like a mishmash. Just yeah, let's just do a show about witches. Hopefully, we'll get this up and coming band to sing the theme song for us. And let's just see how it goes. And I thought it was, like I said, it was very wacky. It was very goofy. I'm not going to pretend it was as slick and as polished as The Worst Witch was. But I kind of liked that it was a mishmash.
Yeah. I mean, I went straight on to episode two then, like, to try and give it a chance. So the bell, they wake up, the bells are ringing in the belfry, Sunday service. And a woman's baked triple chocolate brownies that looked amazing. And the little boy in church has got a pea shooter, that little Chris Tucker boy. And he's like shooting a woman. And this woman turns around and she goes, you're a horrible little boy. I was like, even though he is, that's still a bit harsh. And also, what's he doing with a pea shooter in church? So when Harold gets up to do the sermon, he's like, dearly beloved, we're gathered here today to witness the wedding. And then the younger vicar's like, no, that's not the right one. He's like, okay, we're here for the funeral, such and such. He's like, no, that's not the right one either. So he's kind of like, he gets up to deliver the sermon, but he doesn't even know what he's delivering a sermon for. And then the church people were singing in their thing. Old Noshi doesn't like it. She hates it. And then they find a trap door to get out. Skirty Mum can walk through doors. She's like, doesn't matter. But Old Noshi can't do it. And then she finds a trap door. They get out. And they think that church service is a trial. The witches are causing mischief. And little Christopher, the ratbag, is getting the blame for everything that they're doing. The witches are playing on the belfry ropes. And the vicar's like... So they're playing on the bell ropes and they're ringing the bells basically, and the vicar goes up to see what's going on, and they're eating bats as well. And he's like, "What the hell are you doing?" And I just wrote a note here that bats are endangered, so you probably shouldn't do that. Vicar lets him stay there for a few nights. He even brings him some clothes. Christopher goes to see what's going on, and he stops him and says, he sends him away basically, so he doesn't think. The old meanie woman, baggy woman, has said, she says to Harold that you have to eat healthy. He's like, lifts up a cloche. He's got like some lettuce only for his lunch. And then, what's the young vicar's name? I keep saying the young
Ben.
So Ben says, like, hey, listen, don't worry, because someone baked some brownies and they're in the church. And it turns out that she's found them, and she's like, oh, you can't have these, and starts eating them herself. So they go off and they go to the post office, which isn't open because it's a Sunday, and they go in. She makes a door vanish away, but Gertie Mum's already walked through the door. They pick up the brooms from the shop, like a convenience store kind of thing. And then the policeman comes, and also meanwhile Christopher's watching them, and he kind of goes into the shop as well. They leave the shop, and then the policeman comes and sees only Christopher there. So he's in trouble again for what they've done. Episode 3. So it continues. The crime scene's there, and the meanie bag woman was quite funny, because all the people of the village are like watching Randy. He's like, oh, go home. There's nothing to see. She's like, go home. Like, well, have you got nothing better to do? This and that and the other. And then she goes in and asks what's going on. And she's like, oh, it's none of your business kind of thing. And she goes, I've got a civic right to know what's going on. So she's just as nosy as everyone else, but she's just a bit more forceful about it. Ben, the young vicar, goes to tell the witches off, because they're thing. Old Noshi starts crying for some reason. And the bells are going off. You hear church bells. I was like, but they're in the belfry, so they wouldn't be going off, unless there's another church nearby, I guess. The witches can't get their brooms to like behave themselves. They're casting spells on the brooms to try and make them behave themselves. And all the brushes in the village are going crazy. So like the hairbrushes are going crazy, the broomsticks are going crazy. And eventually they make them like behave themselves. And they're writing a postcard to Mrs. Abercrombie saying, oh, we're actually enjoying ourselves here. Thanks very much for banishing us, kind of thing. And that's all I watched of that episode. There's probably a lot more to it, but.
Okay, so I watched episode 5. And it starts with Mrs. Bagmeely trying to kill all the bats in the belfry. And yeah, so at this point, it's clear that everybody knows about Skirty and Noshi. Like Ben, he's asking Chris if anybody else knows. And he goes, I think it's just me, you, and Harold. And they're obviously thinking, oh, Miss Bagmeely's going to find out about them. And so I think Skirty like shrinks her and they put her inside a jar. And so the witches are struggling for food because there's no bats, because I think she manages to get rid of them. And they find out that there's a talent show in the village. But Chris was telling like the Skirty and Nosh that they might not be able to enter because Ben won't let them. It's Ben's birthday and they want to try and get him a present. Polly gets him this big jumper that he can't really fit in, but he's wearing it anyway. I think it's obviously clear that Polly has a liking to Ben. She's infatuated with the young vicar. And the girls, as a present, want to take Ben to Witch Island. And yeah, so basically Ben is off on his motorbike and he's going somewhere. And then he could see like Skirty and Noshi with him. And they're like, you know what, we're going to take you to Witch Island. And they're basically having fun. They're having a picnic. And they've been seen. And Purple Stockings are chasing after them. And they somehow manage to get away. But then Detty, who was the assistant to the Queen Abercrombie, was like, if you ever come back to Witch Island, I promise you it's the last thing you will do. And the Skirti and Noshi were saying, oh, our spells don't even last that long anyway, because they left Mrs. Bagmili with Harold. And Harold's just basically keeping her in a jar. And he goes, oh, okay, I'll look after you until the girls come back and whatnot. And they're left alone with Harold, and they get worried. And then Mrs. Bagmili turns back to normal. And then I watched episode 8, which was Thanks for Nothing Day. And so it's basically celebrating the day that Witch Island was free from evil wizards. Chris comes to the Belfry to visit, and the girls are expecting a present. They get each other a present, which was radio and batteries. You put it together and you get music. And then Mrs. Bagmili, I think a lot has happened since episode 8, and she wants revenge for about something or the other. And obviously the girls want to try, and Skirti and Noshi want to get something from the shop. And the police officers come to the shop, and he's like, yeah, there's loud noise coming out of the radio, and I want that turned off. And obviously, I think the police officer knows about Skirti and Noshi, and he goes, basically, look, I don't want no more magic around here. And the music gets turned off, and that's because there's a black cat there, and she just basically tips over the radio. And Ben is telling them that he saw a black cat, and Skirti and Noshi are getting nervous that it might be from Witch Island. And Jimmy was like, I'll get you guys a drink if you can let me go on your broom. And then, yeah, so the Queen is trying to fix the transmission on the radio, via the radio, to see what they're up to. And the Queen is basically ordering Detti to go to the village to try and stop the girls. And, yeah, Mrs. Bagmili, she's still trying to plot revenge about something. And Chris offers his Walkman to the witches, and they enjoy it very much. And Detti comes to the village, and she sees Mrs. Bagmili, and they want to take down Skirti and Noshi, and that's how that episode ends. And then I went to the last episode, which was episode 13, and Skirti, Noshi, and Chris, they're basically coming back from Witch Island. Detti is in disguise in order to infiltrate the village, and Mrs. Bagmili wants to take over, and taken over by making the residents sign over the lease of their house so that they can turn it into some kind of a beach town kind of thing. And Jimmy, the little boy, is basically helping out with their plan. And they all think it's a competition that they're entering, and they have to put all of their money in some kind of trust fund, and they all get to go to America. And Ben and Harold are having a talk about this, and Harold's saying, oh, look, this competition is going to be a great idea. We get to go to America, and, you know, this, you know, beach thing is going to bring, you know, more money and more people to the village. And yeah, Polly's getting worried about all the changes, and she sees Chris for the first time since coming back from Witch Island. And yeah, so the girls and Chris are spying on Mrs. Bagmili and Jimmy, and obviously she wants all the forms to be signed so that they have to, you know, sign the deed and leave town. And yeah, so Detti doesn't want to work with Mrs. Bagmili anymore, because she's like, you're just a bossy old lady and whatnot. And then Ben goes to see Ted about the competition. Ted's like this farmer, like just a common farmer, whatever. But he refuses, and he doesn't trust the idea of the trust fund and where the money goes. But then, you know, Ben is kind of convincing him about it. And so Jimmy and Detti are coming to the community center with all the forms, and the police officer trying to talk to Jimmy, because he's like, son, what are you doing? You know, you're a good kid at heart. And so Skirti and Noshi crash the meeting, and yeah, so they kind of turn Detti back to a witch, because they're like, look, she's a witch. And everyone goes, what are you talking about? She's a witch. She's not a witch. The only two witches are, you know, you two, old Noshi and Skirti Mom. And they're like, no, she's a witch. She's a witch. And then turn her back. And they kind of realize that they have signed all the, like, their lives away on the forms. And Mrs. Bagmili is like, who says the bad guy doesn't win? Ha 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 ha. I'm just going to walk away with all these forms. But I think the girls managed to change the forms around a little bit so they don't sign up their homes. And yeah, so the girls are flying around with Jimmy and Chris. And Jimmy's like, you know what? Maybe I'm going to be good. being good is the right thing to do. And that's how the episode ends. I mean, for the sake of formality and order and the integrity of the podcast, let's choose our favorite shows out of the two.
Do you know, I think without the Netflix version of The Worst Witch, I think it was very, very close. But, you know, I enjoyed the Netflix one, so I'm going to go with The Worst Witch. Like, they weren't much better than each other in terms of, like, entertainment value for the older ones. The first episode of The Belfry Witches was incredibly difficult. But, yeah, for me, The Worst Witch, I think, just pipped it at the post.
Oh, that's very, what was I going to say? I'm obviously going to go with The Belfry Witches. I thought that show was really, really good. I thought it was wacky. It was very goofy and fun. And yeah, I just thought it was one of those where I kind of liked that about it. I thought it was very endearing in that sense. So, yeah, I'm going to obviously go with The Belfry Witches. And yeah, that'll be a good place to bring it to an end. Of course, many thanks to Nabs, who joined us. I should have asked her about her socials, but I can kind of tell you. You can follow her on Twitter at NabsPat, all one word, NabzPat. You can also follow her alter ego, Auntie Shagufta, on at @official_auntie_s. And you can also follow her on Instagram at @nabs_pat. And yeah, she's got all of her stuff on YouTube as well. So you can check out all of that stuff. It's all very funny. It's all very hilarious. And, you know, definitely go and check that out. As for Yesterday's Capers, we're available wherever you get your podcast from. So wherever you are around the world, please give us a listen. Please give us a shout. Subscribe. Do all of those things that you're already doing, and we definitely appreciate each and every one of you. And yeah, you can find us on the socials at Instagram. It's Yesterday's Capers 1. We're on Twitter at Yesterday Capers. We're on Facebook at facebook.com/yesterdayscapers. You can find me on the socials at Abdullah_Moallim on Instagram. You can find me on Twitter at Abdullah Moallim, all one word. Give me a holler, give me a shout. And join us next week for another episode of Yesterday's Capers.